Good morning, friends. Today I'll be discussing the important questions in the biological oxidation and the electron transport chain. Now, there are two ways the questions have been given. One is the 10 mark question has come. Enumerate the components of the electron transport chain. Describe the synthesis of ATP. Indicate the sites where specific inhibitors act. And give examples of uncouplers. The second question has come as a diagrammatic representation of mitochondrial ETC and the location of ATP synthesis. Now I'll be discussing mainly the first question, which is a 10 mark question, where you have to give the diagram. You have to give the diagram, indicate the different complexes of the electron transport chain, and then go on to briefly describe the flow of electrons from one complex to the other, and then describe the synthesis of ATP, again emphasizing on the chemiosmotic hypothesis. Then you have to give the diagram for the site of action of the inhibitors, and lastly we should give the examples of the uncouplers. Now the diagrammatic representation of the mitochondrial ETC would have been probably a 5 mark question. Here the emphasis would be on the diagram. Definitely the diagram has to be given very clearly, but at the same time you should also be able to show the flow of electrons from one complex to the other. Very briefly describe the flow of electrons and very briefly describe the ATP synthase complex where ATP synthesis occurs. Now as the second question is also a part of the first question, I'll be dealing with mainly the discussion will be mainly on the first question. Now first of all you should tell what is the electron transport chain. Here we have a chain of electron carriers, and through this chain of electron carriers or the complexes, the electrons are being transferred. The flow of electrons is always from electronegative to more electropositive components. Now, what is the site or the location of the electron transport chain? This location is inside the mitochondria. So both the ETC, electron transport chain, and the ATP synthase complex exists in the inner mitochondrial membrane. What is important is that you have to have an intact mitochondrium, because this is essential for the development of that electrochemical gradient. Okay. Now this inner mitochondrial membrane also contains a number of exchange transporters, and this important one of this is the ATP-ADP transporter. So diagram is important, as I told you. In both the questions you have to give the diagram. So this diagram gives the location of the complexes, complex 1, complex 2, complex 3, 4, and the fifth one, the ATP synthase complex, may be regarded as the fifth complex. So, but if you think of the major complexes which is transferring the electrons, they are four membrane bound complexes, and this is located in the inner mitochondrial membrane. And there are two mobile carriers. The two mobile carriers are coenzyme Q and cytochrome C. As you can see, complex 1 is the most electronegative, and it carries minus 0.32 volts. And complex 4 is the most electropositive and carries plus 0.82 volts, and the redox span being about 1.1 volts. So this diagram is very important. Right at the beginning, you have to draw the diagram. Now, you also have to show that each complex, you can see, can donate or accept electrons, and they are passed on to the mobile carrier. So this permits the passage of electrons from one carrier to the other. Finally, it combines with oxygen, reduces the oxygen to form water. Now what happens? You also have to show in the direct diagram that the flow of electrons results in the pumping of protons. From the matrix, it goes to the intermembrane space across the inner mitochondrial membrane. So you see a collection of protons in the intermembrane space. Okay. So during oxidative phosphorylation, the ATP synthesis occurs by the catalysis of the enzyme ATP synthase using the energy from the proton gradient across the membrane. Now then you have to describe briefly the different types of complex, that is the complex 1, complex 2 to complex 4. Now complex 1 is known as the NADH dehydrogenase complex, so it is also known as the NADH coenzyme Q reductase complex. Now what is important about complex 1 is that it is binding NADH. It takes up 2 electrons from it and transfers them to the mobile carrier coenzyme Q through FMN and FES, FES being the iron sulfur clusters. Now this transfer of electrons from NADH to coenzyme Q results in the generation of 12 kilocalories per mole of energy. And this is enough to expel 4 protons from the matrix across the inner mitochondrial membrane to the intermembrane space. So the flow of electrons you can show as NADH to FMN to FES to coenzyme Q. So this is another way of representing the flow of electrons from NADH. It gives the electrons to FMN, which gets reduced. Then electrons are passed on to the oxidized iron sulfur clusters, which gets reduced, then is passed on to coenzyme Q, which then gets reduced. Now the contributors of this NADH are enzymes which are present both in the glycolytic pathway and the tricarboxylic acid pathway. So includes enzymes like malate dehydrogenase or glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase or alpha-ketoglutarate dehydrogenase, pyruvate dehydrogenase, isocitrate dehydrogenase and so on. Similarly, describe complex 2. Complex 2 can be known as the succinate coenzyme Q reductase or the succinate dehydrogenase complex. Here, 2 electrons are being passed from succinate when succinate is converted to fumarate. Then you find that FAD, the coenzyme, gets reduced to FADH2. So FADH2 is formed during the conversion of succinate to fumarate. Now FADH2, reduced FADH2, then transfers the electrons to the iron sulfur clusters, and then the electrons are then passed on to coenzyme Q. So, but this transfer of electrons from succinate to coenzyme Q does not liberate enough energy for pumping out protons into the intermembrane space. So substrates which are oxidized by FAD linked enzyme will bypass the complex 1. So succinate can, this is a flow of electrons, succinate to FAD, from FAD to FES and then enzyme Q. So similarly you have to explain about complex 3 and complex 4 as I have discussed with you in previous lectures. So those details you have to give. Very briefly discuss the flow of electrons and the role of the mobile carrier cytochrome C. Then we come to ATP synthesis. Now when you discuss ATP synthesis, first you have to talk about the proton motive force or the chemiosmotic hypothesis. Now as I told you, when electrons are being transferred from one complex to the other, you find that complex 1 drives out 4 protons, complex 3 drives out 4 protons and complex 4 pumps out 2 protons. So a total of 10 protons are being driven out by the complexes 1, 3 and 4. Now because of the pumping of protons, what happens, there is an unequal distribution of hydrogen ion on the two sides of the inner mitochondrial membrane and a proton gradient is therefore generated. Now, what are the two components of this gradient? The two components of the gradient is the chemical potential energy due to difference of the concentration of hydrogen ions, and the electrical potential energy due to difference in charge on the two sides of the inner mitochondrial membrane. Now, this energy, that is the chemical potential energy and the electrical potential energy, which is inherent in the gradient, is used to synthesize ATP from ADP and PI. And this is catalyzed by an enzyme which is known as an ATP synthase enzyme, which is a multimeric, that is, it has different subunits. Then go on to discuss the chemiosmotic hypothesis of Peter Michel, who proposed it in the year 1961. He said that the oxidation and phosphorylation is coupled, and this is coupled due to the proton gradient which is generated across the inner mitochondrial membrane. So this proton motive force is caused by the electrochemical potential difference, and this is the one which drives it towards the synthesis of ATP. And this occurs by the flow of protons. This protons which is present in the intermembrane space flows passively back into the matrix through the proton pore. Only if it goes through the proton pore of the ATP synthase enzyme does the synthesis of ATP occur. So chemiosmotic, the chemical reaction, is coupled with proton transport. And if ATP synthesis does not occur, the transfer of electrons is also blocked. So what are the basic principles of the chemiosmotic theory of Peter Michel? There are three basic principles. First, the major electron carriers are organized, as you know, in three complexes. That is complex 1, 3 and 4, which is spanning the inner mitochondrial membrane. This structural feature permits the pumping of protons from the matrix to the intermembrane space across the inner mitochondrial membrane. Second important principle is that the inner mitochondrial membrane is impermeable to protons. So once it is pumped out, it cannot diffuse back through the inner mitochondrial membrane. So you have a collection of higher protons outside and a generation of an electrochemical potential gradient. Now, when do the protons? The protons flows back down the electrogradient only through specific channels or pores of the ATP synthase complex. So it just cannot move through any portion of the inner mitochondrial membrane. It flows down the electrochemical gradient only through specific channels of the ATP synthase complex. So the free energy is released as protons flows back into a zone of lower concentration, and this free energy released is coupled with the phosphorylation of ADP to ATP. Then you draw the diagram of the ATP synthase complex, which is very important. Whenever you are asked about ATP synthesis or you are asked a short note on ATP synthase complex, it is extremely important for you to draw the diagram. Okay, so I told you it's a multimeric enzyme. That means it has got a number of subunits. Okay, the two major subunit is the F1 and the FO. Okay, F1 and FO. Now the F1 contains 9 subunits, and these are of different types. You have 3 alpha, 3 beta, gamma, delta and epsilon. So it is like a knob. Okay, knob, and you have the stalk. So what does a knob contain? Knob contains the 3 alpha subunit, the 3 beta subunit, and it also contains the delta subunit. Okay, and it has the gamma subunit. Gamma subunit is like a shaft or a rod which passes through the F1 subunit. Then we have the delta and the epsilon subunits. They interact with both the F1 and FO part of this complex of the ATP synthase. Okay, so you find that the delta and the epsilon subunits are in contact with both the F1 and the FO portion of the enzyme. So this knob or the head of this enzyme projects into the matrix, and it this contains the phosphorylation mechanism. So in the knob or the head of this enzyme is where the synthesis of ATP occurs. That is for the F1. Now let's look at what is this FO subunit. FO subunit you can see is like a drum. It is like a disc-like structure. And it is spanning the membrane. It has three types of subunits, A, B and C. So C subunit is the one which is arranged as a drum or a disc, and it has a central tunnel. Now, as I told you, it is spanning the membrane, and this is the one which forms the proton channel. Now, the central tunnel acts as the proton pore, and the which allows the passage of protons from the intermembrane space through the inner mitochondrial membrane to the matrix. Now, this disc C is associated with the A subunit and two B subunits. So, B2 means two B subunits. So, the two B subunits is a dimer. It acts as an axle. And you find that the beta 2 subunit is interacting with the delta of the F1. Okay, it interacts with the delta subunit of F1. So Boyle's model is the one which is explaining the synthesis of ATP, which is also known as the binding change mechanism. So according to this Boyle's model, the flow of protons through the FO subunit will cause a clockwise rotation of the F1 subunit along the gamma shaft. This causes a conformational change in, so F1 subunit has that knob which contains the alpha and beta subunit. So this causes a conformational change in the alpha and beta subunit of F1, and this conformational change and the rotation results in the conversion of ADP to ATP by combination with PIF. So each of the three, alpha and beta, so you have three alpha and three beta, they have a binding site for ATP and for combining ADP and PI. And this whole mechanism has been likened to a water-driven hammer-minting coin. So three conformations are assumed in a successive manner following rotation of the subunits. So you have the open conformation, which has the least affinity for ATP, and any ATP which is bound is released. You have the tight conformation, which has a high affinity for ATP, and in this conformation you have the condensation of ADP and PI to give ATP. And we have the loose conformation, that is where you have the binding of ADP and PI. Now this covers the aspect of the electron transport chain and the flow of electrons and how it is harnessed as ATP through the ATP synthase complex. Now we come to the third part of the question, that is the inhibitors. What is the site of action? For that, this diagram is very important because it clearly gives you exactly where the inhibitors will act. So what is it doing? It is, these inhibitors are blocking the flow of electrons. And there are inhibitors which specifically inhibit ATP synthase complex. Okay, so synthesis of ATP from ADP is prevented. Now you can see the site of action, like for example, pyrazidine, amobarbital and rotenol will inhibit the passage of electrons from complex 1 to coenzyme Q. Now malonate inhibits the transfer of electrons from succinate to FAD and then to complex 2. Now inhibitors like carboxin, which is an ion or TTFA, which is an ion chelating agent, will inhibit the passage of electrons from complex 2 coenzyme Q. British anti-Lewisite and antimycin A blocks the passage of electrons for complex 3 to cytochrome C, whereas things like hydrogen sulfide, carbon monoxide, all of them, or cyanide, will block the passage of electrons from complex 4 and prevent the formation of or the reduction of oxygen to water. So you have to explain, you have to draw the diagram and explain, like for example, complex 1 to CoQ, coenzyme Q, the inhibitors are barbiturates, which block the transfer from iron sulfur clusters to coenzyme Q. I told you in the case of complex 2, that is in the transfer of electrons from succinate to fumarate, succinate to FAD, you have malonate as an inhibitor of complex 2. Complex 3, very important, is British anti-Lewisite or BAL. And this BAL is used in the treatment of heavy metal poisoning or as a chelating agent and interferes at complex 3. Other inhibitors are antimycin and dimer caprol. Now, where complex 4 is concerned, we have the classical poisons like carbon monoxide, cyanide, hydrogen sulfide, which can arrest respiration. That is, it can totally arrest respiration. And cyanide binds to the heme of cytochrome AA3 of complex 4. Now, in addition, we have oligomycin. It inhibits the flow of electrons through the FO subunit of ATP synthase complex. So it is acting at the level of ATP synthase complex. So that is why the second major subunit of the ATP synthase complex is known as FO, where O represents oligomycin. That is, it is inhibited by the inhibitor or the antibiotic oligomycin. Then there are certain inhibitors of the transporters, like the ADP-ATP transporter inhibitor. One is attractylocyte, inhibits ADP-ATP transport. Then you have ionophores like valinomycin. This valinomycin will allow potassium to permeate across the inner mitochondrial membrane. It dissipates the proton gradient, so no gradient is formed. Okay, so there will be no coupling of oxidation and phosphorylation. Lastly, if the ADP concentration is decreased, then there is an inhibition of ATP synthesis. Now we look at the uncouplers. Uncouplers are those which dissipates or destroys the proton gradient. So these uncouplers, they create a proton leak. So it allows the protons to re-enter the mitochondrial matrix. So it is not coming through the channel of the ATP synthase complex. It is coming from wherever there is a leak, it comes through the mitochondrial membrane, and therefore the gradient collapses, and so the energy cannot be captured as ATP. This is because the proton concentration on both sides of the membrane becomes equalized. Okay, and such uncouplers can be of two types. You can have the chemical uncouplers like 2,4-dinitrophenol and 2,4-dinitrotriesol. And you have the physiological uncouplers like thyroxine and thermogenin. Now please remember, the uncouplers are also a very important part of the examination. KUH exam very often asked examples of chemical uncouplers and examples of physiological uncouplers. You have to know them. All right. You have the ionophores also, which dissipates the gradient. And they, like valinomycin, as I told you, they permit the potassium to go across the membrane and thereby causing a membrane leak. What is this thermogenin? You all know it's a protein present in mitochondria of the brown adipose tissue. It is present in all newborn mammals, including humans. It is acting as a channel for the migration of protons from the intermembrane space to the matrix. So this is forming a channel. Thermochannel forms a channel on its own. So it is not coming through the ATP synthase complex. And therefore, this uncouples the oxidative phosphorylation. Energy cannot be therefore trapped as ATP. Energy is released as heat. Okay, so this is why you have an uncoupling of oxidation and phosphorylation. Now, the release of free energy as heat meets the need to warm newborn babies and maintain its body temperature. Another question which is asked in the university exam is, what are high energy compounds? High energy compounds or energy rich compound are usually substances which on hydrolysis yields free energy which is equal to or greater than the energy released by the hydrolysis of ATP. So the delta G for ATP is -7.3 kilocalories per mole. So those compounds which liberate energy less than 7.3 kilocalories per mole, that is lower than the energy obtained by the hydrolysis of ATP to ADP plus PI, are known as the low energy compound. You may be asked examples of high energy compounds. So examples of high energy compounds include ATP, GTP, UTP, etc. So you have the list on one side of high energy compounds. Please remember examples because they are important. And examples of low energy compounds includes glucose 1-phosphate, AMP, and fructose 1-phosphate. Now, creatine phosphate is also a high energy compound. It's also known as a phosphagen. Okay, there is no oxygen which is required. So creatine phosphate can be broken down to creatine and you have release of one molecule of ATP. So this is very often used by sprinters or athletics for an immediate source of energy. So in athletics or by the athletes or sprinters use creatine phosphate for an immediate source of ATP. The ATP yield is 1 per creatine phosphate. Okay. So what is a phosphagen? Creatine phosphate is an example of phosphagens, which is an immediate source of energy. Thank you.